Welcome to a bonus edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. It is an encore edition. Yes, that's how I'm getting past going into February for season six. That's what we're on. And plus, it's on tour. Although I only went to 8 shows during the season and have recorded like 50 episodes elsewhere. I am rejoined by a guest that hasn't been on since season one and has since then stolen every idea I've had. But in return, I've stolen all of his in return. It's the heavy metal hooligan. It's Mikkey Vago. Welcome back on.
Hello. I mean, I can't argue with any of that. That's fair.
No, I was going through. It's like, yeah. Oh, you start a podcast, and then yeah, I think we have pretty much stolen each other's ideas as we go along, which is
yeah, a little bit.
Steal for the best, I suppose. That's what they say. Yeah, how you doing?
Yeah, good. Days off. I've got a beer, so I'm ready to go. Rock and roll.
I am on the water. I'm on the Evan Young.
Evan Young water, yeah.
I'm on the water because as people may notice in other episodes, I've still feel the cold. I think I've had it since about December recordings. I'm still blaming Christmas chaos for it, for arriving in a Christmas jumper, no jacket, and then did it again at Granite City, just jumper, no jacket.
Maybe then I stand inside the venue with a jacket for 5 hours. That'll do it.
I wasn't one of those. I was not one of those. Although I was outside for far longer than I should have been at Christmas Chaos, considering I sat at the back, and I was like right outside the front door.
Like, understandable if you want to sit in the front row. Not so much if you're 4 rows back.
I know, it was a stupid idea, and I got to end up speaking with folk I didn't want to speak to. It was a horrible night in general. I mean, the show was good, but the general experience around it. It was one of those times because for Inverurie, I asked if I could go backstage and go see you guys first and get a couple of bits and pieces. And I did it, and I was like, I felt really comfortable doing it. Like, you guys are great and everything, but I just felt like that's not a place I should be. I should be in the queue, and then I'll talk about it when you're not there. So that means if I really need that, I just don't go back. Easy, simple, sorted. It worked for SWE, it'll work for Rest of Zone. So yeah, I thought, yeah, I should have just asked if I'd go backstage again when I was sat in that queue for ages. Anyway, so the last time we spoke, it was December 2020-ish. Last episode of season one, there was no shows on. There was a pandemic on. There probably was companies still running inexplicably, but you know, that's by the by.
Yeah, they know who they are.
It's been a little while then, so that's what, three, just over 3 years.
It's been about a while since then.
A little bit. We've fit a lot in. I think right about the time we spoke last, you were just starting your in-ring workout routine to get back into it, which was, I think it was just finding a pair of dungarees. I think that was the battle plan.
Very flattering. Very flattering.
I know. I think everyone that's been on a podcast since that have seen you wrestle going, Eagle's looking great. He's looking
tremendous shape. Nah.
Tremendous shape. And it's
just hide it well.
Just a pair of dungarees, that'll do. So we'll kind of do a little bit about going back. So it was the Mosh Pit before the shows. It was. Mosh Pit was before the show's return, wasn't it?
Because
it
was
long after we had a chat, wasn't it?
I mean, yeah. I mean, WrestleZone did their lot of podcasty type things.
Mm.
It was a handful of us on them. And then you started your one. And I got a taste for it. So what's the meaning? Well, that must have been 2021, I want to say.
Yeah, I think we had a chat about January.
The t-shirt's 21, if I remember right. So it must be like the first one, we recorded a bunch of them just after New Year. I recorded about 4 of them in a row in 1 week and saved on. It took me like a month or so to get them edited and lined to go up. But that must be start of 21 is when we probably kicked it off.
I like that you've put way more effort into your podcast than I have. And because
I mean,
in comparison, because we spoke about it briefly before you started it, because you just asked for a couple tips, and my tip was like, I don't know, I've got Zoom and Windows Movie Maker. That is about it. I don't have any other discernible skill here. And then you've got custom music for it. You've paid for it. You made a nice graphic. You haven't paid for Zoom, but
keep on the down. But I paid for the music the first year. I didn't pay for it since.
Fair enough. I just went to YouTube audio library and just went, that one sounds all right. Well, the second year, because everyone, I had like three complaints about people not liking bagpipes. So I changed the music for the for like season three onwards. Well, the English. It was mostly English people who didn't like it.
Pandering, that's what it is. Pandering.
Gotta get my hits somehow.
Yeah,
I'm not doing it by asking the hard-hitting questions.
it
So yeah, you started the podcast. You got a taste for it. I mean, the episodes were just hilarious, really, because you didn't give a
I
fuck.
mean, they turned out like the original plan was not how they eventually turned out. Like I spoke this they spoke to yourself about how the logistics are getting it working. And I run the original idea by Scotty, and we did the pilot. And the original idea was because you were doing the wrestling and stuff, we were going to try and stay away from most of that and do more a music type thing. But that only really worked for like just Scotty and Martin and Thunder. So then we was obviously me obviously speaking of Scotty, you know yourself, it can go on. There's a lot of material there. So we found it just brother stories, like about the. Because I'll be honest, it wasn't making massive numbers. It was doing all right. But I'm putting it down to a lot of that was the boys listening just to hear their own names and hear the brother stories, and that's what seemed to bring everyone on.
That's it. I mean, I always found the mosh bit was just like, because at the time I was trying to keep it very professional, and I would only ask wrestling questions. And a lot of guests are like that anyway. They don't really keep their guard down when they're on these kind of podcasts, which is fair enough. The more I get guests back on, the more they lower their guard, and we get a bit more wild on the show, I suppose. But I always find that mosh pit was like the older brother, the one that when you weren't when your parents were out, they would just like just maybe take something off the top shelf and just go, have a wee nip of this, it'll be fine, kind of thing. And
I mean, I think the advantage, part of the advantage was it's like, obviously, if you're interviewing guys, a lot of the time you're only speaking to them for the first time. Like, these are guys that have been around for years. I've been around them, been pals with them. And then put on top of that, it's lockdown, so nobody's working, so everyone can have a drink. Back at like Tuesday, Wednesday nights. It loosens up. So I don't really need to do a lot to get them to open up.
I mind when I did it, which is your low, which I think I got the award for the least listened to episode, which I'm quite proud
An
of, for our Mosh Award.
award.
Awards and award, exactly. I think I went through 8 beers through the chat, and I was just towards the end, I was just like, ah, fuck David Lowe, I don't care anymore. And then we did the awards, and I just ended up just in the corner, just looking really confused, like why am I here? To be honest, this is just oh well. But that was, I mean, it keeps you occupied, keeps you in the name sphere as well. Because when the shows came back, there was a lot of Mikkey Vago fans,
There was,
for
yeah. It did help me a little bit, yeah.
because of course Kyle and Kaylee only wanted really to come up because Mikkey Vago was on the show. She wanted to see Mikkey Vago do the wrestling. So the shows came back then. You had the Halloween hijinks. You were put straight into the Halloween brawl, if I remember rightly.
That was the first of the annual, what seems to have become the annual Mickey and Caleb Triple Threat Invitational.
That's it. Well, Caleb does have a question about it, so we'll just ask it. He's just
That
who are we having for our annual autumn triple threat this year?
oh, this year? Oh, I don't know. Well, given autumn is a few months ago away, even if Caleb still got his belt and Aspen still got his belt, I mean, we could just get Aspen in and I could get a crack at two belts.
There you go, two Bell Vago to end the year.
Yep.
Why not?
I'll have that. Thank you very much. So if the booker's listening.
But did you find that when you were speaking to people after the show that the podcast was popping up a lot more, or did you notice a difference from the general WrestleZone audience? Oh, hello.
Right, you'll have to say that again. The internet's
All right,
dying.
cool. Mine went a bit funny as well earlier. I was just saying that, did you notice when you were speaking to
Yeah.
people after the show that the podcast was getting brought up, or did you find it was more just a general WrestleZone audience with a couple pockets of podcast fans?
No, I mean, we get obviously the guys at the show and the or we get it in the alleged group chat that may or may not exist. Like, you get the guys, the voice speaking about that in there. But yeah, there is, like, I've had fans at the wrestling shows come up and bring it up, and it seems, like I said, it's not in massive numbers, but it does seem to be popular with the folk who have discovered.
Is there any that you've put out that you've regretted? No, not
No.
even. I mean, I suppose again, hits are hits. So if you pass out during an episode, that's everyone's going to watch it just to see you pass out.
Some would call that a low point. Nah, it's memorable.
That's it. That's the best. Has to be the way. You've got to look at it positive, I suppose.
I mean, if the recorder just stopped there, but the fact that Thunder and I think it was Caleb was on, and they carried it on till the end, that's what made it for me. Like, it was just a blank screen in the bottom corner where I'm supposed to be.
It's just, it was like it was big telly viewing of the if when it came on, just like new some came up. It was it Archer? I mean, you got so many of your I would say guests, your pals, just pissed on the
Yeah.
podcast. Like Art, I remember Archer. Archer was just getting belligerent towards the end of an episode,
Yeah,
and
Archer got muted at one point. That's enough of that. Archer, Connor, he had a good go at it once. I can't remember which episode. It was the one we did with Evan when Evan wasn't drinking. Connor was drinking for two that episode.
It's just it's great. I mean, I think for this year, with the last year or so, I've been trying to implore companies just to do shit like that. Just do maybe not that exact thing,
Yeah,
because
maybe do
get there,
that
go get what he is, get everyone else drunk and just start shooting on folk. That'll do. But no, just do that kind of content, because that's how you get people to pay attention and to find out more. I mean, I'm sure there's going to be at least a handful of folk that have went, oh, I like this guy. What if he's got any matches on YouTube? Oh no, there's no matches on YouTube. Which
I mean, that's I didn't ken the ins and outs of why wrestlers would never do that, but I think they should. Like, obviously, we're very limited by the amount of guys, folk that can come to our shows because are we up in that top corner? So I think that having stuff, more stuff online would definitely help. But that's, like I said, that's
Right.
above my pay grade.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's it. But for folk like myself, I mean, I'm in the Northeast, so it's lucky I can go an hour and a half, and I can see you guys
Yeah.
most months. But when I'm looking at other companies that are down south or Central Belt, and I'm like,
Yeah,
I can't
too
afford
far.
to go. And also, I like my own bed, as sad as it sounds. I like to
Yeah,
come home to my own bed in the morning, see my boy, and I'm all very happy again, and I've got to see some
I
wrestling the night before. I've become so old since our last chat; it's ridiculous. You know, I'm in my hoodie doing interviews with a probably. If it was warmer, I'd have the Mosh Pit T-shirt because I have a name on it. Of course, I was going to wear it. Of course, I was going to buy it. Big Mark.
That was one of the smartest things I'd ever done. It's like, yeah, I'll put everybody's name on a t-shirt because they'll buy it, because we're all just fucking egos.
I know, I've sold a few when I did it for mine. I was so happy. I was looking at it going, ah, got you, it's just reeling you in. I show us your name on a t-shirt. Ah, it is, buy it. Repost it at the start of the month. Well, I'm beautiful. But speaking of your merch, like your designs and that, they're your custom gear that was noticing like the bigger shows, your hijinks, your chaos of that
Yeah.
you're getting kind of just custom gear for you, and I was noticing, I'm assuming it's your family as well, they've all decked out in the same kind of shirts at these bigger shows. Is it just
Yeah.
a case of you just do a nice limited run just to make it special, or is it ideas for possible merch for future? What's how does it go through your head?
Is just, I obviously, since we came back, I did. Like, even though me and Archer were still a tag team when we came back, we weren't doing any tag team stuff as such. So it was a lot of single stuff I was getting. So I didn't have the onus into making gear for two people. So I was like, oh, well, I'll just make it. And then it got to the point where I think the first one was the Anarchy shirt, or the, no, the Battle of the Nation shirt, the blow off with Ronin King. That was the first proper one I did. It was like, oh, I could just make it like a, what looks like a tour t-shirt. So it's got the dates on the back and the design in the front, whatever. But I'll just do one. And it was, I would pay attention to selling it because I had Mikkey Vago Motorhead ones made up. And I always just end up seeing that carry, like, I've always got like 10 left I've carried for show to show. So it's like, nah, I'll just get one made up for me. And if the families want some, they come to shows or friends or whatever, I can get a couple made up on the side. But it snowballed for there. So it's like, ah, oh, well, had the one for the Anarchy the following year with Archer. The Halloween stuff I did. The Kiss stuff I did the last Halloween show. I thought, but yeah, it's mostly just for me. Just to stand out for a short show.
Oh yeah, just, I'd freshen up the look. I mean, I'm not saying that the wrestlers was looking to get action figures out, but that was always was William Regal's advice was always to just tweak your attire every so often, just so it keeps it fresh and you get another action figure out of it.
I
But
mean, I've got, I mean, four different entrance jackets now, and like five different hats,
the wings.
and the wings. Yeah, I don't know when I'm ever going to use them again. That's the problem. It's like I don't know what to wear them every show, obviously. But it's like when like the Comic Con might be one. I'll bring it back out again because it makes sense to do it there. But yeah, apart from that, it's like I put far too much time and effort into making those just for one show.
I know you put more effort into that than you did the trophies for your badges.
Yes, infinitely more time and effort. Yeah.
I was inspired by your by that when I did our year-end awards last year, and I was like, oh, I could make something, and then I just went, oh, I was going to go to Asda, they're £1.50 for a pack of trophies. That'll do. Just
Like, I
write
did notice
SWN.
one sandwich bag of them sitting about the training for a little while. The ones that are still yet to be handed
I'll probably be Aspens, to be honest. He had that
out.
many. Controversially had quite a few for the old Aberdeen Wagathon last year. By the time this comes out, we'll have this year's ones out, and I think they're safe. It's all central belt stuff. It'll be
I'll tell
okay.
you.
Everyone will
I'll
be
probably gonna
happy.
hear that kick off a bit.
Oh, you'll play.
I wouldn't have to kill him off on Twitter again.
Oh, it was just brutal. It was hilarious. It just watched it just going, oh, come on, stop digging yourself a hole. This is just.
It's the fact he kept biting. It's like just far too fucking easy.
I
But
know.
like,
The worst thing he does is he vague tweets now, which is irritating because I'm like, just
oh,
tell
that
us.
annoys me. If
Come on.
you got a gripe with somebody, just fucking say it.
I know. Just yeah. I mean yourself, you're quite open with just tell someone to fuck off on Twitter if required.
I mean, there is guys like the boys. No, I'm far like believe it or not, I am far more opinionated than some of the mosh pit stuff I get away. But that's I sometimes have to bite the tongue just because I don't want to be getting wrestlers own involved, like a bad name, or the guys that are getting bookings elsewhere. I don't want to cost them bookings by saying something I probably shouldn't have.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's. Yeah. That makes sense because.
So when I finally retire, is both barrels.
That's
Yeah,
it. The final episode of the
get
Mosh
into
Pit.
blaze of glory.
Speaking of that, is there any stories you've had to actually cut afterwards that have come out? And you're like, I don't think we could put this out on here.
I
This
don't
might
think
be
so.
one.
The only joke, the only thing I ever caught, there was one in the Omar Ups. I'm not gonna say what it is. He'll know what it is. But there was something we had to cut out of that because I thought, that's too close to the line. And I'm not gonna say what it is, but Omar will know what it is. And
Oh,
probably the guys will know. But yeah, those are some sort of something. And it was him that said it. It was his joke, and I was like, "No, that's." So I run it past Mrs. Vago. I was like I know, like we normally get away with a lot, but listen to this, and she's like, "No, you need to cut that." I'm like, "Okay, it's gone."
The voice of reason,
Yeah,
Mrs.
but that I'm fairly sure that is the only thing I have ever cut off of any of the Mosh bits ever. Like I said, I fucking hate editing.
I know it's the worst, especially I've been noticing that because I've got a cold. The last couple of things I've had to edit out coughing, and our year end awards
Yeah.
that I recorded for an hour, 53 minutes has went out because I coughed for 7 of them, and I was like, fuck, this is terrible. I need to stop doing recordings in December and January.
The worst ones I've got is like if I'm recording with the boys and they'll start calling each other by their shoot names. Like if they're a couple of beers and it's like, I have to fuck it. Like I could just leave it in there, but it's like, nah, because I'm too pernickety about that. So like, and it's not even cleverly edited, it's just I just blank it out. So it's just, there's a space of silence where the name should be and it's gone.
I think I tried that once, and I took because I you're working on Wondershare or something like that, and that's something quite intricate, and you're able to do that. I'm on Movie Maker and hope and prayer. So I tried it on Audacity once, and I thought, okay, I'll blank it out. Great, put it back onto the episode. It went out of sync. I was like, ah, fuck it, you're getting your real names on here. I'm not just that's it now. I'm not editing unless there's only a few things I've taken out. By request, if you request it to be taken out, I'll take it out, or
Yeah.
I'll try to anyway.
No, the boys are warned beforehand. It's like, nah, anything you say here is gonna. I mean, I didn't.
Ian Skinner has been the worst for that because he just ends up going into a rabbit hole, and I'm like, yeah, I can't use any of that. You're gonna have to take it out. Or he's thought next day I'll get a message going, can you take out this big section when I said something really bad? Yes, okay, I suppose I'll do that. But the old people pleaser here, not wanting to ruffle for any feathers. Probably a detriment when it comes to Scottish wrestling. Too
Yeah, that
nice.
rock in the boat.
Too nice. Even though the last two reviews I've done have went just fucking, I've been so annoyed at things in wrestling that I've just watched. I don't know if you read,
Yeah.
if you read any of them because I don't, wrestlers really shouldn't read them, but. I did one. It was a referee doing making a mistake. I wrote about four paragraphs on how fucking stupid it was. I was like, maybe I should be a bit more critical of wrestling now.
Yeah, no, there was that. Was it the W3L one you'd done recently? And it popped up in our group chat, alleged. And it
Action
was like,
Academy.
oh, look at, no, that was one of the recent
Oh,
W3.
the recent one.
Might not have been W3L, might be something else. But it was one short review reviewed recently, and it
Right.
popped up. It was like, oh, look at Billy being actually negative or something.
They caught me at a bad time. Much like Bobby Roberts, if you catch me at a bad time when I'm watching something, I'm going like, I'm nae letting you get away with it. I'm going to pull you up on this now because I've watched enough wrestling to know that that was bollocks. So let's just
Yeah.
call it out. You know, that's my resolution for this year is to actually maybe be a bit more critical and maybe be an actual journalist, I suppose, when it comes to wrestling. Because yeah, my reviews are often too nice. I don't like to be annoyed at wrestling. What's the point? You know, just why am I going to sit there being absolutely raging at something when I could just go, oh, I like this. Let's concentrate on that nice thing. But oh no, that referee attitude that just fucking boiled my piss so much. I was just so annoyed with it. But yeah, so from that point back to wrestling, you won what a title.
I did.
Your first singles title, the old
I know.
Strikeouts Championship, which was a wee bit of a surprise, was it? It was Inverurie, wasn't it? Inverurie 22.
Yeah, against Captain Allen again.
I know that was my first show back after Jack being born because I missed Battle of Nations because he was born 2 weeks beforehand. Absolute shocker. So I missed that, and then yeah, I came back, saw you win a title.
Yeah.
Nice wee pretty singles title, the Tri-Counties. For you though, I mean, I don't know how much titles mean to you as a concept, but was that kind of a reward? Do you feel that was a reward for you for building yourself up through things like the mosh pit, getting your dungarees so you look like you're in better shape? and being able to create that kind of groundswell fan base to put you into that position.
Yeah, I mean, titles, they're neither be all and end all. Let's be honest, we're not actually winning them. But it's nice that the company's putting the trust in you to have it. And I'm not gonna lie, it's nice to be champion. A lot of that, like I said, when we come back off a lockdown, I was doing a lot of single stuff, a couple of matches here and there, and then like January onwards, I was doing the thing with Ronan King. And as much of an arsehole as he is very talented. And that feud, I couldn't have had a better opponent for, because we were so different, and it just the chemistry was so good. And it just cemented that. Yeah, because before that, I was always a tag guy. I love tag team wrestling, but after that wee run I had with Ronan, I was like, yeah, I could be a singles guy for now on. That could be done generous. And then, like you said, they got the shot against Captain Allen at Inverurie and won the belt. Which, like I said, it is nice to be champion. It's very pleasing. You sell more merch.
It's also it was a nice surprise because when you think of like title changes, they're usually reserved
Yeah.
for your named shows, not your live in wherever.
Usually an
So
Anarchy or a Rumble or, yeah.
yeah, so if you go
It's
to Inverurie, you don't think that's going to happen.
a B town as such, yeah. Like it's, but no, that's that. I mean, that was the original plan for the Tri-Counties Championship anyway. It was meant to be a title that was defended in the Tri-Counties. Like being invented, and obviously it started out with the 10 or 15 minute title on it.
So there was. I forgot about that.
Yeah,
Yeah.
this that kind of just fell. I don't know what happened to that. And we just stopped. But yeah.
I think it does pop up sometimes because I think it popped up in Caleb Zach at Nations last year. I think that there was an announcement of a time limit coming up. Can't remember though. That's too long ago. It's more than a
Yeah.
month ago. I've no very little memory of stuff before then. But yes. Well, speaking of Ronan King then. This was just an amazing rivalry because Ronan seemed like such a liability. Anytime he got in the ring, not for me,
I knew for me.
not for you, not for putting you in danger, but for WrestleZone and in the crowd in general, I seemed like a bit of
Yeah.
a liability. For as much as, like you say, much as he is a dick, he is very good, but we're
Yeah.
able to try and impart some wisdom as in. Just calm the fuck down after matches. Just going, can you stop hitting people there in the crowd?
Yeah, it's like the swearing is like you get one and that's it. No more. But yeah, it's like I said, like that was the as much as like I listened to the episode he did with you, and he was very keeping the praise on me about that, and he's just as he deserves just the most credit for it, because he was doing his part. Like I said, he's an arsehole, he's easy to hate, but he is very fucking talented. But
That's
he is the worst wrestler in the world.
I said it
Or it's not
himself.
the best, is it? Can I come up with the quote is, but yeah, it's
Tmail.com/ScottResnet. Go buy a t-shirt yourself. Endorsed by Ronan King himself. But yeah, that's it. He's like Kelly adores him because of that. She goes, I know I hate him, and I hate him when I see him wrestle. But even I know he's really good. I'm like, well, then that's a good thing. I still can't get the vision out of the girl's compo face when she got hit by the guitar at Avni Anarchy. That was incredible.
I mean, if you guys sit in the front row,
Yeah, you take the risk.
yeah,
You're going to get
essentially.
looping sharp sat on you, or you're going to get hit by something that's.
Everyone's got to throw something at you for the thing, yeah. It's got to go one of two ways.
Did I hear rightly? I can't remember if you put it on the Mosh pit or not. Did I hear rightly that you were in charge of filling the guitar?
Yeah. Yeah, that first one was a bit much. Like it was the first one I ever did. God, you can see a break. It's like, ah, that doesn't seem like a lot. A bit more for luck. I said nobody can see anything now.
Oh no, I was just to see, I think, oh, was it when they were clearing it up? Broom got snapped as well. It was just a disaster all around afterwards
Yeah,
between.
and then I think was it Dave P and Sean were on after us, and obviously the floor's covered in talc. So Sean comes back, like, doing his wee dancey thing, slips in his arse, just
Oh,
yeah.
Liz! She fell right in front of me. I was fucking pissed.
So
Oh, I forgot about that.
yeah, lesson learned.
Less. Or just make sure it's done before the first half main. Just do first
Yeah.
half main. Oh man. So Mosh Pit rules then. We'll talk about that and then we'll get into
Yeah.
the end of your Tri-Counties reign. So yeah, Mosh Pit rules. So it seems like a match built for you because it's
Yeah.
Mosh
In
Pit.
fact, that was something that came about before lockdown. We had this idea. Obviously, we'd had Garrick join us and they rejected. So the original plan was when we had originally bought Garrick, the original plan was for Archer to do the single stuff and me and Garrick be the tag team. And obviously it went the other way, but I was getting more single stuff and it was Archer and Garrick were doing the tag team stuff. I don't remember, I'm sure it was a Christmas Chaos or something, when we were backstage and somebody, was it Scott or William Stirling, brought it up. Oh, you could hear this match and you could get it named after yourself. And that's where the original idea came about, and it sat dormant for obviously until after lockdown, and we were doing the thing with rolling. And we were trying to think of things where the what kind of matches we could have. Obviously, I was carrying the Singapore cane at the time because I got a feel for it. The first show back, the Halloween show, I made a bunch of them. I was like, I'm just gonna keep this now. This is just as my new thing.
Right.
I was like, well, we need something bigger than that. And that's where they've, well, we'll bring this mosh pit thing back again. We can do a weapons match, but it's just all guitars and drums and whatever else. And yeah, that match actually went exactly the way we thought it was going to. I kind of fault the. There was a couple more things we would have liked to get in, but because it was the low end, the low ceiling, there was a couple of things we weren't able to get in. But apart from that, I loved that match. That's why we brought it back for Archer. But yeah.
I think this was the continuation of Mikkey Vago being vague on the rules of what's legal in these particular kind of matches,
Yeah.
continuing on from kind of
Loopholes.
the tables. But yeah, so you've found a way to make weapons, particular weapons, legal, which, to be honest, at first it annoyed me, as we are both very aware. But to be honest, now I just appreciate that you do such a tiny little thing to weapons just to go, hi, but that's. That's got that. So clearly, it must be a weapon that
Yeah.
counts. Like, bastard, he's got it. He's got me right there. Can't
Well,
fault.
like the Halloween match with Lou, Aspen, I just painted like what looked like blood on the guitar. It's Halloween guitar now.
What's that? I think I was
Loopholes.
the year before. I think I was Aspen had a just one of those bacon sheets. And he just wrote Halloween on, or he wrote Boo on it.
Yeah.
And then there you go. That's a Halloween item.
There's always a way.
Fair enough. Although Captain Allen still has your beat for the best loophole for Christmas Brawl when he brought out Mauler. Mauler? Yeah, Mauler. He was Mauler Murphy. Murphy and Dino dressed as Tinsel.
Intentional, yeah,
That's top tier. That's
can't
going to be hard to
fault
beat.
that.
You got Tommy Raiden now, though, so hopefully you can just dress him up as something that he could be your weapon. Throw him somewhere. So we end 2023 then, Tri-Couch champion, riding high. You've done things like have pumpkins on your head and all that jazz and guitars and what have you. And then Archer went and punched you in the face and
He did.
that
What an
was it.
honor.
Over. Fuck.
Yeah.
Was it, well, did you always kind of have an idea of eventually having you and Archer do something or
No.
that?
Like, we had no intention of ever breaking up. Obviously, I was doing a lot more single stuff, but we pitched that as well. We're not breaking up as such. We're just Okay, when I got a problem, like that was the thing that any tag team gets together, that eventually they break up. There's one of them turns the other one and say, well, what about we just don't do that? We'll just go separate ways, and if we need each other for something, a tag match, or somebody needs backup for someone, the other one will be there. We can come in. And then he decided to better run and punch him in the face.
Absolutely shocking, and it was a proper shock. Because I remember, I mean, I'm sure you're. I think maybe we spoke to you about it, or someone's definitely brought it up to you about Geddes afterwards when it happened. Oh, incredible! And just him just beside himself,
Yeah.
going to get a wee half pint because just calm himself down because of the
If
rejected leaving, rejected breaking up. It was
we were gonna get anyone, that was who it was gonna be.
Oh, it was just, it was, we actually felt really bad. I was like watching him going, oh, your job. Just.
Yeah. It's like, oh no, did I wear the gloves now or just a bandana? Oh no, what about that?
That's a wee clip of Ellen. And he's still Vago. He's still there for
Yeah,
Vago.
still be his gloves.
He doesn't believe in Archer though, anymore.
Yeah,
I don't know how Archer will feel about that. I don't know, probably relief, to be honest. That.
he's still getting hassled from bananas, I'm assuming. I
Oh,
imagine.
if he's not, I am. I don't know.
Oh, he's there hassling you as well, is he?
Hi.
Amount of messages that like somebody that like Archer gets them. I think the actual wrestling page gets them, and as well, Dave P and Hand like Thunder and commentary, they all get messages about this bandana. Like Archer vaguely promised them one fucking show about 3 years ago.
Yeah, I get them on the YouTube on the WrestleZone podcast YouTube. It's I'm like, what well, I have the least say out of anyone you've asked. I'm sure I have no swinging pool here. This just he said, apparently he sent me a list, but I never got the list because he gave it to Kyle to pass on to me, and Kyle never gave it to me. So I have, and he keeps asking me about this list, and I have no idea what's on it. I've seen one of his lists in the past, but I don't know what list he's on about. Pass
No,
it on to
we
me.
often get a letter or two backstage, and it's yeah, interesting to say the least.
He's just, yeah. It's part of the furniture for WrestleZone.
Yeah, but he's
He's fine.
harmless. It's
Oh, yeah.
fine.
He's fine. But yeah, sometimes when there is a point where you just go, I can't help you with these bandanas. Honestly. I don't know what to say. I've got a t-shirt. If you want to buy a t-shirt, tmail.com/scottresnet, you can go buy a t-shirt.
All right, he
But
doesn't want to buy it. He wants you to
oh, I don't give away anything for free.
give him
I mean, I gave Ronan one of his t-shirts, but to be fair, it's his tweet. I think he kind of
it. Yeah,
he got
he
his own t-shirt.
give you permission to use it. It's only fair.
Exactly. If anyone else wants one, though, they can buy it themselves.
Yeah,
Not charity here. Say that though, if there's any wrestlers or promotions about their merch advertised on the podcast, just give me a shout and I'll easily take it and wear it.
send the freebie through, yeah.
Absolutely.
Sample, sample.
Sample, that's the one. I'll put it in the
Yeah,
background, just to show it off. XL.
I
Actually, at the moment after Christmas, 2XL and just
a tough couple of months.
oh God, tell me about it.
I almost had to bring the dungarees back out.
Archer, your feud with Archer seemed a bit snake bit though. It didn't. It kind
Yeah,
of.
it's couldn't you didn't really get going,
No, I think
but
between
it's
yourself, I think Caleb and Alan had the same kind of issue as
yeah
well the year prior. That just COVID,
yeah
the world
just
just ruins it.
yeah I mean it is what it is. We got where we needed to go eventually, but yeah, I think that's we're not, there's no coming back to that. That's it, we're done.
But I mean, the mosh pit at Anarchy though was a riot, because I hadn't seen the first one, because my damn child being born, so I had to I didn't see it. So to see it actually in action and all the additional things you added, the drum was hilarious, because I had Kelly next to me just going, oh, I really hope he hits him with that drum. I really hope he hits him with that drum. And then as soon as it happened, he was like, yes. I was like, oh. Best thing, watching someone excited at wrestling. I've watched it for 20 years now. I'm Mellow as fucking wrestling, but to watch her excited, two guys battering each other with drums and guitars and a stereo that didn't really work.
Oh, was it new? It didn't work like it should. And then when it did work, it wasn't anywhere near as loud as it needed to be.
That's the
So
thing. It's in Dane Stain and Grant and Richard Edge, you know, just because the ceiling's so high, you
yeah.
can't hear anything. It's
It's like it's just like it was a portable wee stereo. It was like ah, that sounds like that'll be fine, and it like I said, it's fine when you listen to it in your house. It's like yeah, that'll be loud enough, and then you get in a big arena like that, and the sound just disappears.
it's one of those things. Like if you're doing another one, it would be just to maybe have a word with someone at the sound desk going, right, when this happens, play this, and it'll all work out in the end. Here we are, just shutting in all the. Before, when I started doing this podcast 3 years ago, I was like, "Oh, wrestling's real," and now here we are, 2024,
Secrets
and
of
I'm like,
wrestling revealed.
"Oh, I'm sailing the cat, dude, giving you all the rules and secrets." Everyone knows, but
I mean,
for 3 hours, you just pretend not to know. That's
like
the.
everyone's in on it now. It's fine.
I know. I mean, to the point where wrestling's going to be on Netflix in 2025. That's just
I
mental.
saw that, yeah.
That's bad. It's just,
I thought somebody did say, it's like, oh, well, like, I've near here, obviously, but in America, it's like if you want to watch WWE, you need to buy like three different streaming things. Because obviously, Raw's on one thing and SmackDown's like, if you've got the time and patience to sit through everything that WWE sticks out, fair play to you.
I know, but these are the same fuckers that moan about which Money in the Bank being on at like 5 a.m. I'm like, oh, poor you. Here we are every month at 1 a.m. and trying to stay awake and hoping for the best. If I get through Royal Rumble this year, it'll be a bloody miracle because I haven't made it through any other show in the last 6 months. Oh, God.
Yeah, just it's like just cut some of their matches. You don't need a 7 hour show, it's fine.
I mean, that doesn't matter now. If it gets to past 3 o'clock, I'm like, nah, I'm going to bed. This is gonna be the most amazing match coming up. I'm like, I'm gonna watch it in my bed, and then I'll fall asleep about 10 minutes afterwards. But
Aye.
hard life, especially now juggling. Before, again, when we spoke before, I was bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, and
Yeah.
now I've got a 10 or 18 month old who likes attention. He sleeps through the night, but still during the day he doesn't. So that's why I'm still gutted that we didn't hold on to Battle of the Nations, because I was really hoping for that,
I
those free tickets for life. I was like, come on.
you weren't guaranteed that. That was just an idea I had.
I know, but I think we could have, I could have at least like kind of forced the issue going, come on, just come on. But no, it's. And when the rumors broke, I was like, can you not hang on for just 2 weeks? Just 2 weeks, that's all you need. Just no, okay. Fine, here you come. So, back to the questions then. We do have a question from Adam. It seems a bit kind of related to our questions about the Avery Bankathon. He's just put international blood on a family show. Sorry, intentional blood on a family show. Discuss.
Like I did see this. I'm fairly sure that's a thinly veiled attempt again. Be riled up about Bobby Roberts again.
Yeah, probably.
But
That's
yeah, I mean, obviously you've got your death matches and your gutsy blood there. Family friendly show. It's. I think at that point, it can be okay, but. If like Bobby Roberts should be in front of 30 folk, probably ain't worth it.
And in this context as well, like if for example, I mean, Ronan and Damien, they had a big feud, and Damien got stabbed in the eye. There was no blood, but you could have had a wee blood capsule thing there, and it would have made sense in context that he stabbed in the eye. But yeah, if it's just a case of, oh, I'm just gonna, bleh, and that's it.
Yeah, just needless. I if it's part of like a big feud, like a big payoff, like you maybe had a 6 month year thing going with a guy, and it's a big payoff, maybe a big fucking weapons match or some sort of matches, big match, a big blow off. And maybe you could get away with it there on one of your bigger shows, maybe that push. Like I said, it's got to the point where I don't want to use the word soft, but folk are just too sensitive to it now, I think, is the problem. It's a bit harder. Well, obviously, you go back in 70s, 80s, kind of, not across here, but it's like lights of Ric Flair's going across, fucking gigging himself every single night.
Right.
I think times have changed. I think that's the main thing. And it's a bit harder to get. Like, the only instance I can think of it happened at WrestleZone was, and I'm sure there's been more, but I was at ringside for, I'm sure it was Huntley. It was Garrick and Archer in a match, and me and Dave P were at ringside, and Garrick did a dive. And his head bounced off the floor, and he bumped, obviously hard waved himself open, it wasn't meant. And that's the only instance of blood I could think of off the top of my head that I've seen in WrestleZone. Like I said, I'm sure there's been more, but it's.
But yeah, it's context, because I remember Omar busted his nose, I think, against Archer's head which was the instance. So,
But
but yeah.
it's not intentional. It's not the men that do there cutting themselves open for them.
So speaking of deathmatch wrestling, any interest? Are you keen?
Possibly.
Oh,
I
very
mean,
good.
just to get one, maybe just to tick off the list.
There you go. Bleeding gums. There's your call. Give Vago
I'm
a shout.
not. I'm sitting by the phone. That's what I'm doing. It's my match graphic. Just use a phone.
Oh, that was one of the best graphics I saw. Your grizzled vet. looking for bookings. Is that a goal this year? Is it any interest in doing that, or is it just a case of if it
I'm
comes?
not chasing bookings. Like, I've never been actively chasing bookings. Like, I've part of that graphic came off a meme that is used in the alleged group chat. Anytime the guys bring up like FCW or CPW, I know FCW, the guys say they've bitten a word for me there. But obviously, I'm not actively chasing it. I've not got a CV to send as such. So anytime they mention it, I just put that in like, oh, I'm just John or Kev, just need to get on the phone. I'm sitting here by the phone.
No,
But yeah, it's someone I would consider, but it's not someone I'm actively chasing.
that sounds fair,
I mean,
so
it would be nice to work another place just to, like I said, just to tick off the list. I mean, me and Archer got offered a match in, was it BCW at the time? Years ago, but we couldn't make it. It was Dennis's wedding the same night, so we couldn't do it.
all right.
But yeah, looking sharp phoned us up one day out of the blue. So, oh, can you come down and can you be partnering me, Krieger? It's like, Cara, we've got the wedding. But that's the closest I've ever came to working anywhere else.
So maybe this is the year, 2024. Get Vago booked,
Yeah,
but
said
he's
that.
thinking he's
I'm
going to
sitting by
ask
the
you.
big red phone. Yeah.
So you mentioned looking sharp just this past Saturday as we recorded. You were against Lou in a tremendous match, if I do say so myself. It was a good fun, but no cartwheel.
Was.
Was there? No memory of a cartwheel.
I mean, it was about a green because that's the first time I've been in a ring since like mid-December.
Ah.
I was like half pace off what I should have been. I slipped a disc in my back the week before Christmas, so I'm still recovering from that. Yeah, no, there was a cartwheel in there. There was one.
I that's a shocking that me is
Cartwheel elbow into Foley knee into big boss one in the ropes into a boot.
I remember the boots. I don't remember the
Yeah, well,
cartwheel. Oh shit.
it was with three things before that
Oh
then.
no, this is terrible. This
Like
is
I said, I wasn't moving as well as I should, so it maybe just didn't look like a cartwheel.
aye.
Although
Well,
it's not a cartwheel anyway, it's a springboard. Handspring elbow.
oh, I was gonna say, yeah, has all
My
right.
mine's a handspring elbow like Muta does, not like the other one that gets done in Scottish wrestling. That's a
is it like
dubious cartwheel.
you don't have a kendo stick, you've got a Singapore cane? Is that kind of
Yeah,
the
same
distinction? Right.
thing.
So
Context.
But yeah, it was just, I love that you guys brought up the Devon Dudley stuff, and it's that's why I like about wrestlers when I go to the shows, because there's going to be folk there that have only been there for the last two shows, year maybe, and then
Yeah,
I'm heckling.
that's something that happened like 10 years ago.
Yeah, no, I'm heckling in the corner going, and I even I was speaking to some of the guys that I was sitting with, and I was like, they're speaking about looking sharp, and I was like, you know, he beat Devon Dudley, and they were like, yeah, he mentions it like near every week that he's beaten Devon Dudley, and like then.
Conveniently forgets it was another two guys that helped them beat Devon Dudley, but yeah,
But
plenty, plenty of his moment.
then the first thing he did when he came out was shout, "I beat Devon Dudley," and I was like, oh,
Yeah.
"Yes, this is the best thing ever." That's the sort of shit I like on wrestling. You can keep your flippity doodles. Give me something. Give me a call back to something that happened 10 years ago. I'm there. I'm for it. But you get injured before shows, though. I remember speaking to you before your match with Archer at Anarchy, with your hand all wrapped up.
Yeah, because I'd sliced the like a fucking 3-inch gash in my thumb. Yeah, no, that was fun.
So
Try to wrestle one hand.
you should have stuck with just putting the powder, more powder. Just needed more powder. Didn't need to do all this stuff and cutting stuff up. What else have I got noted? Just have a look. So you got Tommy Raiden now as your new wee pal. That sounded
Yep.
so much more condescending when I said that out loud.
My wee pal light.
Your wee pal.
Yeah.
So again, just now that I was noticing. Like when shows came started coming back, Brian Tucker kind of had this role of being, if you're a newbie, came through him a little bit. But now you're kind of in that role because you had Judas Gray. And I mean, looking sharp, of course, he's been in and out for a few years. But now, do you find that now that's your kind of possible role at the moment in WrestleZone? And you've got Tommy there to kind of the impart wisdom, sage thing going as well.
Yeah, I'd be happy enough with that if that's what Russell wanted. So you gotta bring guys in. It's pretty, I mean, it's a lot like the tag thing. Like me and Archer, once we were a couple of years in, we were the level that tag team needed to at least match before they were worth anything. So like the outfit or the foundation, like they're far better now than we ever were. But yeah, at the time, the tag teams had to come up to our level. I think it's if that's what Russell want me to do now, that's fair enough. I'll happily do that for them. If they're bringing guys in and see how they are, but yeah.
Being a bit the gatekeeper, so to speak, of WrestleZone. Speaking of that, Judas Gray just put, "Oh, you only beat me because your little sidekick distracted me with a cheap shot." Judas Gray, that was a fun match at Christmas Chaos as well. A bit different because he's not like he's quite a unique wrestler for Scotland,
He is,
certainly.
yeah.
What was it like?
I mean, hopefully we'll get him back because he's very talented. Like I kind of follow him on that. Gobby as fuck, but yeah, that's what you want, especially for the wrestling crowd that needs somebody like a character, and that's what he is. He's a character, but yeah, I mean, he kept pushing it to Tommy, so Tommy gave him what he fucking deserved.
That's been my bugbear on previous road trip ones. I'm like, does Vago know? Does Vago know that Tommy? Because I get
No.
right into the shows. You hear me now. If I'm writing a review or doing the podcast afterwards, I'm all in on the stories. I'm just, I don't. I think about a six paragraph thing about William Sterling getting battered by the foundation. I was all on board. I wanted to write everything about it.
You know me, Billy. Loopholes. So as long as the ref isn't the same there, it's fair game.
Make a note of that in the future. There you go. Arsehole. Right. But is there anyone that you've been recommended to have a look at in Scotland that you think, okay, maybe they could I can give them a go, see if they can hang in WrestleZone?
Maybe as such, I mean, there is guys who are working at other places, but maybe come back with a name or two. It's like, well, it might be worth taking a look at them, but it's like the point where wrestlers are now, where we are on our roster, it's like we've got that many guys who are that good. It's like, who are you going to drop to bring somebody else in? Like, they need to be really, really good in order for us to drop a guy off a show.
Yeah.
Like the same argument they have with this not so much now, but after the speaking out thing, the women's wrestling thing, the wrestling never got any women's wrestlers. Because we'd have to bring them up to Glasgow and drop two boys off our shows to bring them in. And are they going to put as good a match as our two guys would have put on in the first place? Probably not. So why would we do that? Just to tick a box. Doesn't
That's
work.
it. My that's kind of my argument back to it is do you want a token match or do you want a match that has been built? Like if you've got a match that's been, because that's what used to be when there was women's matches on the wrestling shows, it was usually Emerson, Jane, and Debbie. That was
Yeah.
kind of the, and then you get Emerson would batter Debbie for any number of shows, a couple shows in a row, and then management would get Viper in. And that's the reason why you got
Essentially.
that match. So it was always there was a reason for matches. And yeah, I'm the same opinion. I would rather have a match that's been built for a reason than just go, oh, here's two women, here's a match. But yeah.
Like I said, the other part is you've got guys training two, three times a week, some of them. And so you're at turn around and say to them, like, you're not in the show this week, just we need to get a couple of women in just to tick a box. You just can't do it. It doesn't make any sense.
No, that's not against any good wrestlers because there's plenty of good ones. There's plenty of great ones as well. But yeah, it's logistics at the end of the day, as well as making sure that your current crop and roster and talent are that are earning their matches as well. It's a very dicey subject that we're probably starting to wade into the waters of a bit too far. That we may or may not get cancelled for.
I could go further, Billy, but I don't want to get your podcast cancelled, so we'll
Leave
just
that for the last
carry
one. Leave that for the mosh pit finale. When you reveal all the group chat, the alleged group chat
Yeah.
messages that
I mean, I the boys listening right now are very disappointed in me getting any further with this, I guarantee it.
but I mean it's yeah. Well, listen, we'll move on because I think again it is something that I don't know enough about as a very white man. I've no idea what other people are going through when it comes to representation. I'm represented quite well,
Yeah,
in life.
we get right.
I think between the two of us, we're like, yeah, let's solve every problem. Us two white straight men, let's do this. Yeah. So anyway,
Moving on.
moving on quite quickly. How do you feel about Scotty Swift and Buell stealing the podcast concept and doing the Granite City Horror podcast?
Yeah, he's what I like. I do enjoy it. Like I've said to Scott and Boogal, like I've never been a big horror movie guy. I like the occasional zombie flick, but apart from that, it's not something I really get into. But I do enjoy listening to them. Like I've said before, any of the wrestling guys could start a podcast on something that they're passionate about, and I would listen to it because I just like hearing my pals speak about something that they'll enjoy. But you know. Like as much as I'm never gonna watch any of those films, I do enjoy them speaking about
I've said the exact same thing to Scotty. It's like I enjoy listening to the podcast. I have no intention to watch any of these
that.
films though. There's it's not my thing and not at all.
Exorcist 2, probably
No.
not. Not for me.
I'm just amazed that Scotty has been able to condense a chat into an hour. That was the thing that baffled me when I saw the runtime. I was like, this part one of this just
I mean, you say about them stealing the podcast earlier. It's someone we've got in the pipeline for the Mosh, but to be a movie type thing because we've run out of things to speak about now. So we've
Well,
got like the music thing we did, and we've got a couple of things for like movie things we might like to do.
we did have Kirsten who takes the photos at the shows. She should ask when there was going to be more mosh pit. So that's kind of the idea now.
I am trying to bring it back because obviously last year there was kind of like two episodes or something, I think. Three maybe. The year before that, it was the same. We did a couple of galas and that was pretty much it. So this year I am trying to bring it back fairly regularly. At least get more than a handful of episodes out. But yeah, it's someone we have discussed between like the usual, we've got the usual. Like the birthday bash thing, it's about. We call it the metal side chat that we've got. There's me, Scotty, Marvin, Caleb, and Thunder. And we use it for a lot of, like, if there's gigs coming up or music type stuff, it doesn't really fit in the Legend chat. But we've kicked around a few ideas in there. Like I said, there's a couple of movie things we thought about doing, or more like we did the Iron Maiden thing. And it did less numbers than usual, but we enjoyed doing it, so fuck it, we're just gonna do it again, but with someone else. And I am trying to get guys back on, maybe like the likes of the Outfit. Because obviously Murphy's never been on before. Likes of Tucker and Dawkins, maybe, or Tommy and Ollie Green, because they've never been on. And maybe bring back guys that have been on before, just for a wee catch up and a couple of years again. But yeah, it is someone I'm trying to bring back semi-regularly. But I fully realise I've said this before and fuck all's come of it, so didn't hold your breath.
It's one of those things that, I mean, the way you're mentioning that is you prefer a group chat. You'd rather not do like one-on-one chats. You prefer just having a group of guys on, or girls, group of guys or girls, maybe not girls after that chat, but guys on the show,
Yeah, unlikely.
just so you can bounce around a couple of voices instead of just like what I'm doing, scrambling for
Yeah.
questions and what have you.
I think the one-on-ones were fine, like the first time you get a guy on. But after that, we've kind of run through most stuff that we could fill an episode with. So I think once you've got, if you bring them on again as a one-on-one, you get a lot of awkward silences, or you're trying to think of a question to go into someone else. I think with a handful of guys, you've got a bit more scope to keep the chat going, or other things spring up here and there, and you often tangents here and there. But I think the getting at least two or three other guys on definitely helps.
Certainly for myself, I found that with the birth, what was mine called again? Dave Birth Bonanza. I was furious.
Definitely not stolen.
I was furious because I had it written down in my wee schedule. I have a wee schedule written down for my episodes, and I had Billy's Dave Billy's birthday bash. I had it written down in there for ages. I had it planned out, right? That's what I'm going to do it July 2nd, and then like a week later, it's Mickey's birthday bash. I'm like, kind of put that out now, so I have to really use a ham-fisted term, Dave Birth Bonanza. It sounds terrible, and it just ends up just being me telling my guests to fuck off. That's what's happened at least twice. Alex Webb got one because he asked a question. He asked a really simple question, like, "Does this count?" I went, "No, fuck off," and I was just yeah. It's one of those. I find that the environment of a group chat, it goes into the Wild West quite quickly because of you just get fed. You get fed up with people. You're just like going, "Can you all just shut up? I'm supposed to be hosting this. Can you?"
Sorry, waste of time. As long as you're like Archer drunk and you just have to, like Arch, now you're trying to go on mute. That's it, you're done.
is it all? Are you kind of just going to keep it Missile Zone based? Because that's the folk that you
Probably.
speak about the
It's
most, or
easier.
yeah.
I mean, I think try to round up guys that I've never spoken to before. I'll just end up being awkward, I think. Especially with the stuff that I'm doing. It's not like your regular, the stuff that you're doing, basically, how'd you get into wrestling? And then
No.
that's not the stuff I'm doing, so it doesn't really work as well with somebody I don't really know.
Yeah, the shite questions, really. It's just
I was going to go with standard, no shite, but
my podcast. You're not gonna reinvent the wheel anytime soon. I'm very aware of that, but I'm still one that thought, should I ask Scott Hoy what his favorite dinosaur is? Ah, fuck, I've got this far with the podcast. I'll be as well.
I never got asked that, I'm just saying.
Did you not? Did that question
Nope.
start? Was that season two that
Or
question
the
start?
sheep thing.
Oh, well. I've now got two extra
Stay
questions to ask. Ace.
tuned, folks.
Stay tuned. See how long I'll wait before I run out of things to say. And go,
What's your favorite dinosaur?
what a ridiculous question to have in our question set. And it's still in it. It's all. Well, I'm going to stop it for season. I'm planning to not put it in season 7, but eventually, if I get a guest who's like giving me nothing, I'm gonna have to go.
Yeah,
What's your favorite dinosaur?
stand by.
That question crops up, you'll know why, because it hasn't went well. The two sheep and cow one, though, that's Luke and Sharp's fault, so he can take the blame for it. And people take spend way too much time thinking about it. Like I have never cut out the silence, but I do sit there going, could you say something? It's a podcast. Come on. Stop thinking about this question.
Yeah,
It's very easy.
there's no right or wrong answer. It's fine.
Well, there is a right answer, and most people are wrong, but it's just, come on. So yeah, podcast and plans in the future is maybe may happen. Don't
Trying
count on
to.
it.
I'm in the process of trying to work out dates and figure stuff out. But yeah, hopefully in the next month or so, I should get some stuff recorded and released, hopefully. Obviously,
Well,
we're doing the birthday bash. That's a sod. Bringing that back. Bring a quiz to a quiz.
Oh yeah, you did play guitar again though, or
No, we're done with
no?
that. If the last couple of things, that's not worth it.
I mean, I'm gonna just manifest it in here. Get Devon Dudley on, although I think you got to pay for Devon.
I ain't paying for a price to come on.
No. As soon as I see that on Twitter, someone goes, if you want me in a pot, I think it was Doug Williams, put out a thing going, if I'm too old to do these things, if you want me in a podcast, pay me. I went, oh well, scratch him off the list. Never
I
going to
mean,
speak to him. And I understand
it's fair
why.
enough. He's not trying to build a name for himself anymore. He's not no real reason to do it.
Yeah,
It's
fair, yeah.
understandable.
But
Also,
yeah.
Doug, at the end of the day, it's Doug Williams.
End of the day, I got Scotty Hotty on. It didn't cost me a penny. It cost me three.
Yeah.
Cost me about 4 months of my life trying to get hold of him, but it didn't cost me a penny. And so can't say fairer than that. I'm the Impact guy now, apparently,
Yeah,
because I spoke to
proper journalist.
I as I say to everyone, I have no idea how I got onto that. I don't. I asked them if I could speak to Joe Hendry, and I ended up on their press pass list. I just.
They forgot to take you off
They must have, and they still put me
it.
on. Like I'm sitting there going, they're going to let me ask a question, are they? Oh, they have. Oh no, shit. What do I do? Do I ask something? Because I'm the Scottish wrestling guy. Do I ask something about Scotland?
What's your favorite dinosaur?
You know what? I was going to come to that eventually. It is because, well, the first time I did it, I was like, I called them TNA, and it was when they were Impact, and I was like, oh, this has gone terribly, and yet they
Think they
invite me
deserved
back.
it.
So.
Same thing.
So, eventually get the mosh pit on the press pass. So you can ask. I'll
Yeah,
be there asking Moose a question.
that'll be what I want. They're gonna forget to take me off of that.
That'll be the one that they've signed. Bill James, and they'll go, Mickey's mosh pit, and you'll be like, fuck off.
I'll be surprised. We're an hour and 50 minutes or so in. I'm surprised it's taken that long for you to mention Bull James.
I was just excited to see him on the AA advert.
Yeah, that's one thing in the group chat. They know if anyone. Just in your mention of his name gets me riled up, and I'm straight on there like, fuck you, you fuck prick.
Well, I noticed when it was put up about you and Lou, they went, "Oh, these two have teamed up to face greats like such as Devon Dudley, the Hurricane, and Carlito," and that was it. And I
Yeah,
was like,
that's good to say, greats.
I was going, there was one more though, wasn't there?
Yeah,
William
like I
Sterling.
said, no greats though.
Have you mellowed out about Bill James, or is it still just
No, he's still fat, Brug. Just a wanger. Like, it's got to the point where, like, it was a joke to start with. Like, it wasn't a joke to start with. Like, I genuinely thought he was a prick. And then I kind of joked about it, and I've just worked myself into a shoot now where it's, nah, he is a prick. Fuck him.
Poor Bull. Sitting, I never spoke to him. I wasn't paying him
Yeah,
a tenner.
lucky you. I fucking wish I had no fucking bullet either.
It was one of those when some of the guests come up in Alderaanic and going, oh, I've saved £10 there. I'm not going to get a photo with them. Who else is on there? Hurricane. Yeah, I'll go meet Hurricane. That's fine. But hopefully that's if the rumblings that I heard mainly from Guinness are true about having the Anarchy next year or this year. Have you already put your list in, your personal list in for imports?
Yeah, I've asked for just an import. I'm not forcing it. I'll take it. Perfect. As long as it's named Bull James.
Oh, but you've got to finish the story. That's the thing now in wrestling, finishing the story.
it's a 30-second squash match where I'm just kicking the shit out of him, I'm not interested. I'll be honest.
The My Way promo going there.
Just one guitar shot and it's done. That's it. I'm happy with that. I'll take that. But nah, other than that, nah, I'm not interested. But yeah,
No, that's it.
I've not heard anything about. The problem with imports now is like all these guys they're signed to AEW or Impact or like you could book them and then it they could Impact or AEW could decide that we're doing a showdown and can just sweep their outfit under you. WWE obviously they're the only key guys to work for. And the guys that aren't assigned really are they really worth booking? Like are they really gonna draw a crowd? On top of the guys that we've got anyway.
I think possibly off the top of my head, maybe one exception, and that would probably be Mark Cardona. That would probably
Yeah.
be a guy that ticks the probably the WrestleZone audience of mid-2000s wrestling nostalgia,
Yeah.
and him being a big enough name on the indies to draw a casual crowd in as well. I would
Yeah.
say he'd
But
probably
and the
be
thing
there.
is, like I don't know the ins and outs of it, like are they involved in any of that kind of thing. But obviously, I don't know. I'm assuming Matt Cardona is charging quite a bit for these kind of shows. It's like a risk and reward thing. Is it really worth booking him? And needs to get bringing as much as he's getting paid.
That's the thing.
And
And
I could be completely wrong. He could be charging peanuts. I don't know. But yeah, looking at it from the outside, that's and that it just might be the money. It's the problem. I don't know. It's.
well, here we are. We're fixed women's wrestling, and then we're going to fix business practices as well. So we'll. But we've seen things like, well, we saw Granite City Showdown that just with the core roster themselves, they can still pack like half of that hall that was cordoned off for the show. So there's not to say, I mean, if they brought back a like sort of a Grado or a Joe Hendry, that they can't push that whole
I mean,
hall.
the only reason we only sold half that is because we capped it at that. There was no other reason, like we could. I don't know if we could have had the whole hall for that show, but it's. I know that that's what we capped at. Well, I'm guessing that's what we capped at. But yeah,
I think if the weather was better, it probably would have we've done better. But yeah, it was the whole week of weather warnings and what have you, and walk ups.
The snow doesn't really help with that. It's what else. Well, just look at our record last year. The amount of sellout shows we had last year, you could probably maybe one or two shows we had run last year weren't a sellout. Every other show we ran was selling sold out.
I know, I felt like a right dick doing the WrestleZone podcast. I thought, oh, I'll set this up. I might shift a ticket or two. Then every show I did, it was sold out by the time I started recording it. And I was like, here's the card, I suppose. Just kind of buy a ticket. So I'll be there. I'll probably be there. Oh, no, there's a storm. I can't go, you know?
Look at the selling shows on the, and that was just on the back of just the roster we had. That wasn't bringing anyone. I mean, we brought in the Saints a couple of shows for the Dundee or Perth or whatever. But apart from that, it was pretty much all our own guys we were using. There was no imports. There was no really any central belt guys we brought up. And that's us selling pretty much every single show.
I think it
It
also
was.
helps when we talk about you not looking for bookings, but if you get some great, but we're seeing guys like the Foundation and Aspen and Caleb and that all kind of doing well about the country, and now they come up to WrestleZone and you get to see them there, and that doesn't hurt, I suppose.
I mean, it must be bringing people in, seeing if they're seeing these guys on their shows down there. It must be bringing people, or it certainly must bring eyes onto what wrestlers are doing. Whether they're coming to the shows or not, I don't know. But it's certainly bringing attention to what we're doing up here is far better than fucking anything else the company's going on, in my opinion.
I mean, I would like to agree, but I've already been accused of biased that enough many times.
I mean,
although,
is it biased if you're right?
there you go. I mean, there probably is times, if I went back and watched some of it, there probably is points where I've went, yeah, I probably have been way too nice about that particular moment, but I didn't care. I was there and I enjoyed it. I think that's probably that when I'm harsher about reviews than that is because I'm watching it after the fact. I'm not there at the time and soaking it in and being part of the moment and all that kind of stuff. Whereas I'm sitting there going, that referee is fucking awful. Why the fuck is this referee doing this? Why am I just no, stop it. But yeah, it's hard course, I suppose. Maybe
I mean,
wrestling companies shouldn't put their stuff out online. Maybe I'm just setting them up just
I
to
mean,
go, you're all shite.
In no way am I saying that everything that we've done over the past couple of years has been perfect and everything has gone planned, or but 99% of the stuff we have done has been fucking brilliant and far better than anything else that anyone else has done.
I'm hard pressed to disagree. I can't disagree with it because
I mean, just
I'm
look
there.
at like our guys are going around other promotions and they're fucking putting on bangers of matches down there, propping their shows up. Like, there's a reason they keep bringing our guys back.
Yeah. Do you feel like a bit of a proud dad when you're seeing guys like Ronin and that just smashing it elsewhere?
Lot of that, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it does feel good to see other, like, obviously it's something I've never done, but it does feel good to see other guys going out there and just making a name for themselves. And like Ronin King and Connor, these guys are giving off, and it's never been easier to make the big step up this, like one of these bigger companies. And it's like, if that's how young they are and that's how good they are now, like, they've got a real chance making a real fucking name for themselves and making it really fucking big.
Absolutely, yeah. I've already. I mean, I could probably put money on now. Certainly, Ronan is going to be signed to a US company by the time he's
and then I could be
25.
sitting here in wrestling zone when I'm like 50, 55, saying, "Can you know, I wrestle time? I was his first feud."
That's it. That's the goal. If you're going to be the regulator of WrestleZone, you may as well be the guy that can go. I watched way back when he assaulted fans and swore at them, and back when he was young, and now here he is, world champion. But I mean, I've got the same thing when I see Emerson Jane. I saw her one of her first matches in 2012 against Nikki Storm, and now seeing her what she's doing now, I'm like, Jesus, like, amazing. And even though we're probably around about the same age, I'm like, oh, well done, you. You've done really well. First saw you when I was 22, and now I'm 30, way old, and you're doing half a good. So, but
then I've gone to ages. I'm 40 this year.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
I feel like death, and I'm 33. I don't really want to imagine 40 at the moment. It hurts my soul a little bit.
I'm the age of what Archer looks.
You're the age of his back shape.
Yeah, and there's legit 10 years between us. He's legit 10 years younger than I am. And it wouldn't be the first time that folk have got us mixed up and thought I was the younger one.
I remember when Archer came back after the pandemic, and he was just like, one of the first things I said was, oh my God, he's standing straight.
Yeah. Oh no, he went and got his back fixed. He had cryotherapy and all this
amazed.
Other stuff done. Yeah.
And then here we are, 4 years on, and going. I mean, you're still moving very well, but you could probably go back for another appointment, possibly. I mean, I say that I'm gonna do that weird old man grunt when I get off this chair later. So I have no room to judge anyone for anything, but. You know, still one of the most solid wrestlers in the company is Chris Archer.
Yeah,
always puts on a good match. Right, we're going to end up just rambling away here, and it's almost 9:30. Oh my God, that's like 1/2 hour past my bedtime now. So, you know, what's your favorite dinosaur?
T-Rex, and anyone that says otherwise is fucking lying.
Fair.
T-Rex is the best dinosaur.
An answer plus aggression. Next up is I don't know what other question to ask here. What about a fight? Two sheep or one cow?
Right here. Well, I just had, like you were saying, just had a long lengthy pause and think about it properly.
Oh God.
No, it's a cow because it's bigger. They'll kick the shit out of two sheep.
I've gotten to the point, it's been a while since I've asked this question. I've forgotten my answer.
Forgot what the right answer
It's sheep. It's sheep. There's a video online of one sheep beating a cow. Two sheep will do it, no bother. That's the right answer. So,
I'm not enough for you. My
Well,
grandmother worked on a farm. I mean, it was a pig farm, but
close enough.
yeah, it's farm animals.
I've spoken to farmers and butchers and everyone in
I
between.
feel unqualified to
I know,
answer.
I have had folk go, "Oh, my granddad was a butcher." Like, he's never going to see them fight, is he? He's killed them. That's thinking
Maybe
what?
that's how he got
Maybe.
them.
Dress up as a sheep, though, to
Fight
beat
to
the
the
cow.
death. Fits on the menu today.
Just get the old woolly jumper on, go around, going to beat up some cows now. Let's do it. Anyway, I think that's a good time to wrap it up and do that. See as we delicately got past some controversial subjects as delicately as possible.
We think completely covering your podcast yet.
I don't know. It's going to come out on February 14th to February 15th. Will be an interesting day.
February 14th, Valentine's Day.
It's a very romantic day for episode 250.
I mean, Nate, for me, I might get that night.
I know.
We spend it.
I'll be having a romantic M&S meal for two. That's why
I'll
we
be in
tradition.
that. Be in Glasgow, want to say. Glasgow, yeah. But Glasgow to see girls' school.
So as
Not
we jump.
to get the center some certain wrestles in the Central Belt excited. I said girl school, not school girl.
There's the ending. Right. So this is the last appearance of Mikkey Vago before he gets lynched either for going to a concert of for with women. That's not the way to word it, but it's fine. Everyone knows what I mean. Hope. Or last appearance of Mikkey Vago after he gets lynched for just being cancelled because. But oh, all right, before we go, you arsehole for that message when you sent me going. Oh, I want you to check this new segment we've done on the podcast. I want you to record your reaction to it. And it was 3 minutes of you fucking roasting me.
cancel Billy hashtag. That
I was both impressed and furious at the same time.
is some of my finest work. I think, yeah,
I've still got the sign. I've still got it
yeah.
somewhere.
Do not allow this man entry.
Anyway, right, okay. So that's the best way to end the podcast. This has been episode 250 of Manscaped. I haven't done the fucking ads in ages.
Shave your balls.
SWN20, 20% off manscaped.com. You can also have your balls looking like the top of my head. Anyway, right, with that, do you still advertise your social media or do you care?
Just make it be whatever. You'll
Mickey
find
Vago.
them. I think I'm fairly sure I'm the only one.
There's only one Mickey Vago. There's only one hooligan in Scottish wrestling.
Yeah, there is, and it's not Brent fucking Carter.
Steak, right? Okay, we're definitely out now. And with that, goodbye.
Ta-ra!